Airbnb has recently published an article where they explain how they encountered performance issues when dealing with complex Swift UI views, how they diagnosed the root cause for these performance issues, and most interestingly, how they managed to solve the performance issues. I've read this article last week. I found it super interesting. I've learned things that I was not fully aware of, and so I figured that I should definitely share its content with you. I'm not gonna read the full article, of course, because that wouldn't be super interesting. You've got the link in the description if you want to check it out, which I recommend that you do, and I will simply go over the key parts of the article. Before we start, if you followed my channel for a few years, you might have recognized the name of one of the two authors, so Carl Stephens, because Carl was on the channel 2.5 years ago, I think. I recall it was towards the end of 2022, and he had told us back then how he had contributed a feature to the Swift language. And so I was really happy to see his name showing up in a new video. So let's start by understanding what's causing performance issues in complex SwiftUI views. The problem is that in some situations, SwiftUI can happen to reevaluate the body of a view even though the state of that view hasn't changed. In this diagram, you can see how the reevaluation of the body of a view should ideally happen when the state of a view changes. For example, a label going from displaying A to B, then indeed the body should be reevaluated to reflect that change. However, when the parent view gets updated, if the state of the child view hasn't changed, so if the label still displays B, then the body of that child view should not be reevaluated. But as it happens, in complex views, it does not happen like this by default for some reasons. So before we understand these reasons, here we can see some example. So a modifier has been applied to the view so that their background color changes randomly every time their body is evaluated. And you can see that when the filter on the top is changed by the user, then the bodies of the views on the bottom are reevaluated, even though the change in the filter on the top did not change anything in the state of the views being displayed just below. And you can see the same thing on the left with scrolling that triggers the body of the navigation bar to be reevaluated. And to understand why these view bodies are being unnecessarily reevaluated, we need to understand how SwiftUI's diffing algorithm works. So this diffing algorithm is what allows SwiftUI to tell whether or not the state of a view has changed. What's tricky is that, to my knowledge, Apple has never publicly published how this diffing algorithm works. So it's more of an educated guess or a reverse engineering process to understand how it's happening. But what's important to understand is that if a view is marked as equitable, so if it conforms to the protocol equitable, then SwiftUI will always use the implementation of equitable to tell whether or not the view has changed its state. Otherwise, SwiftUI will use other approaches. For example, it's going to use reflexing programming, so most typically mirrors, to recursively compare each instance properties. That's for structs. For classes, it's going to compare reference identity. And then you have the types like closures, where SwiftUI needs to apply some kind of heuristic, here using the reference identity, because it's not really possible for SwiftUI to know whether the code in two different closures will always yield the same effect. And here, what's super important to understand is that what SwiftUI really wants to achieve, its main goal, is to make sure that a change in the state of a view always triggers a reevaluation of the body. Because if that were not the case, it would mean that the UI would no longer reflect the current state of the view, and that's a big issue for SwiftUI. So this means that whenever there is a change in state, SwiftUI must reevaluate the body. However, if SwiftUI unnecessarily reevaluates the body, it does not hurt this goal of correctness. It hurts a secondary goal of performance, And it's really important to understand this so that we don't jump to the false conclusion that SwiftUI is simply not optimized enough. SwiftUI is optimized for one objective, which is that of correctness, but less optimized by default for a second objective, that is performance. So now the question becomes, how do we manage to also optimize for performance while not sacrificing correctness? The answer will be in the first point here of the list, which is that if we provide a custom equitable conformance for the view, then SwiftUI will always rely on that conformance. And so the question becomes, how do we provide these conformances to equitable at scale without introducing bugs? Because if we provide an incorrect conformance to equitable because we have forgotten to handle one property in the conformance to the protocol, then we have destroyed the objective of correctness. So it's something that we want to have a solution that scales. So we definitely don't want to make engineers implement the equitable conformance by hand. We want a way to automate it. And as it turns out, in Swift, for a few years, we've had the perfect tool for this. So I'm, of course, thinking of Swift macros, where we could annotate a view with a macro at equitable that will automatically generate the implementation of equitable for us. And where it gets really interesting and powerful is that we can also create a second macro at skip equitable, which we can apply to properties that should be skipped when computing whether the state of a view has changed. Typically, handlers should be skipped because handlers, yes, they are properties, but they don't reflect anything in what's shown in the view. They are simply a way for the control flow to pass on view events to other parts of our code. Unfortunately, in the article, the authors do not share the source code of this at equitable macro. However, if you want to try and implement yours, it shouldn't be too hard. Honestly, I think the problem to solve is pretty straightforward, and I would recommend that you take a look at Sourcery, because before the Swift compiler was able to synthesize automatically equitable conformances, Sourcery did offer a way to synthesize this conformance using code generation, and the logic for the generation of equitable in Sourcery is very likely to be quite similar to what the authors use to implement their at equitable Swift macro. So thanks to this at equitable macro, we are now able to get a finer control over the diffing of SwiftUI views. But we are not fully there for solving our performance problem. Because what's important to understand is that this macro only applies at the view level. So what do I mean by that? Let's scroll a little bit and take a look at this view. You can see that this view has been split into what I'm going to call pseudo subviews, because you can see that we have a header section and an action card section. The code has been split into two distinct scopes using computed property. But what's super important to understand here is that this is still one single view in the eye of SwiftUI. What I mean by that is that even though the code looks like it's been split into two smaller chunks, both chunks are still called in the same body, and there is no possibility for SwiftUI to invoke this property without also invoking this other property, because the only thing that SwiftUI can invoke is the body, and the body is defined at a view level. So why do I mean by that? Why is this important? This is important because it means that if we want our at equitable macro to actually have an impact, we also need to make sure that we split our complex views into more simpler subviews. And I insist on subviews because the simpler pieces of code must be SwiftUI views of their own and not just code refactored into computed properties or methods. So how do you solve the problem in this simple situation? Super straightforward. I'm sure that you didn't need me to show you the solution, but I'm still showing it to you. You simply take the code that's in the two compute properties and you move these two pieces of code into the bodies of two fully fledged SwiftUI views. So that was easy, but it leads us to a more complex and more interesting question, which is how do we make sure in a larger project that involves a large team of developers that every developer follows this good practice of splitting large Swift UI views into simpler subviews that do use fully fledged Swift UI views for their implementations and not just compute properties or methods. And as it turns out, it's not too hard to solve this problem if you use the right tool. So here we are not going to use a macro, but we're going to use another compile time tool, which is the linter, because you can create a linter rule that's going to analyze the body of a Swift UI view, of every Swift UI view in your project. It's going to compute the level of nesting, the maximum level of nesting in the body, and above a given threshold, it's going to produce either a warning or an error asking for the body to be decomposed in smaller Swift UI views. Unfortunately, just like for the at equatable macro, the authors have not been able to provide the implementation of this linter rule. However, I've asked one of the authors and he's confirmed that this rule basically only computes the maximum level of nesting in the body, the only trick being that it computes it taking into account code that might have been moved into compute properties and methods. So you need to keep that in mind, but with that knowledge, you should be able to implement your own version of the linter rule if you want to also put it in place in your project. And now it's time for us to have a look at the result of this optimization technique. You can see that when this technique is applied on the left, now when the view scrolls, the body of the navigation bar is no longer being reevaluated. And on the right, you can see that as the top filter is being modified by the user, well, only the view that contains this filter has its body be reevaluated. But for the views below, their bodies are no longer being reevaluated when the value of the top filter changes, which is exactly what we had set to achieve. And so it's time to conclude this video. What should you take away from this video? The first thing, and maybe even the most important thing I want you to take away from the video, is that, as always, premature optimization is the root of evil. So I definitely don't want you to go into your project and start applying this approach of making each Swift UI view explicitly conform to equatable. Don't do that unless you have explicit performance issues to solve. However, if you do have performance issues in your app and if you think that they might have the same root cause than what was shown in this article, I would definitely recommend that you give this approach a try. I would recommend that you don't try to apply the approach to your full project. Of course, start with a specific part of the project. Make sure that you do see noticeable improvements on the performance and then go on generalizing the approach. And finally, even if you don't have that kind of performance issues to solve for now, I think this article still does a very great job at highlighting one of the limits of SwiftUI built-in diffing algorithm, and being aware of this limitation and how it can lead to performance issues is a very good knowledge to have. And I'm sure that, for example, it could come in quite handy during an interview, a technical interview, if someone asks you, for example, well, to share something not trivial about the way SwiftUI behaves. That's all for this video. I hope you've enjoyed it. Before we end, I have a big thank you to the two authors of this great article, Carl Stephens and Miguel Jimenez. They really did a great job of explaining why SwiftUI's default diffing algorithm can lead to performance issues and how to solve these performance issues. As always, don't forget to like the video and subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss the next ones. Thank you for watching and see you next time.